Chatters, fringers, secret squirrels, and individuals. Welcome to the Haunted Chronicles, episode 261. In 1983, Cyndi Lauper recorded Girls Just Wanna Have
Fun.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Mm-hmm.
We have two great guests for you tonight. Sean Austin and Eric Vitale are in the Haunted Chronicles green room having some refreshments left by tonight's sponsor, Burger King. A word from our sponsor.
Have it your way. Have it your way. Have it your way at Burger King.
May I help you, sir?
Two Whoppers, two Whopper Juniors, and four Coca-Cola. And would I have to wait long if you made one Whopper with no pickle and no lettuce?
No, sir. Hold the pickle, hold the lettuce. Special orders don't upset us. All we ask is that you let us serve it your way.
Oh, well, in that case, could I have the other Whopper with the extra ketchup?
Sure. We can serve your broiled beef Whopper fresh with everything on topper. Anyway, you think is proper, have it your way.
Now that's the way to do things, our way.
Have it your way. Have it your way at Burger King.
Burger King. Wow. Have it your way at Burger King. Please visit BurgerKing.com for a location near you. I am Mr. Haunted, joined by the ghost-busting, psychic student, Italian rice cone-eating, Jennifer Baby Soft Runyon.
Well, hello, Jimmy. How are you?
Jennifer.
Yes, I had my Italian rice balls the other day.
Tell me what that is, quick. I never saw that before.
Okay, they're heaven, and they were fabulous. And it's an Italian thing. I went to this great restaurant, and they make it's cheese and rice, and then they make it, they stuff it with all the, I can't even, it's just too good. Look it up on the computer for the recipes, guys. It's, I'm dying still.
Look at little volcanoes.
Oh, they were so good.
And you know what, Jennifer, I want to forego my, you know, my 2 minutes of telling you how my week was, because it was much good. So,
okay.
So I'm going to forego that, and I want to do a quick celebrity birthdays just with you. These are three really good ones this week.
Let's do it.
But ask me how I am.
Vanna, how are you?
Jen.
Yes.
I'm happier than a water possum wading in. Oh, wait, let me tell you a bit about water possums. They're a semi-aquatic, web-footed marsupial who carry their young in their pouch. In fact, the male and female both have pouches, but only the females can be closed to keep their young dry.
Aww.
Anyways, happier than one of those possums waiting in the azure waters of the Mexican River, and Jeffrey Epstein didn't kill himself.
Oh, oh, that's epic. I love
We're going to do a quick celebrity birthdays. And Sean and Eric, stay in the green room, because it'll be a lot quicker to get rid of them like this. And then we'll get
All right.
Let's waste our time. Okay. Buzz Aldrin.
Oh,
he was part of Three Spacewalks.
Okay, so
jumping right in. Okay. He was part of the Apollo 11 mission that that they say put a man on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
How old will Buzz Aldrin be this week?
Buzz Aldrin will be. I have no idea. 89.
Very good. He's 89. Will be 90.
All right.
And fun fact tidbit I found out.
Tell
I thought you got to think Buzz. But he's just really cool.
I'm gonna take this as mine. Sean Austin.
Sean Austin. He's in the green room.
Yeah. They're in the green room.
Thank you.
I left you guys some Parmesan.
I know. I'm multitasking. I'm picking up some haunted sushi while I'm on the phone with you guys.
Okay, who's the next one, Jim?
Oh, wait. And Buzz Aldrin got his name, not because he's really, really cool, and his name's Buzz, because his sister couldn't pronounce brother, and she called him Buzzer, so they called him Buzz.
Okay. Oh, I love that little fun fact.
Gina Davis, actor known for Thelma and Louise, The Fly, Beetlejuice, and I'm still waiting for the sequel to Beetlejuice. How old will Gina Davis be?
I am going to say that Gina Davis will be 66 years old.
Very good, 64.
Oh, Gina, I'm sorry.
Fun fact tidbit, Gina Davis is 6 feet tall.
Yeah, she is. And do you know that she is an expert archist? That she, you know, the archery and archery,
yes.
I think she was trying out for the Olympic team. I don't think she made it, but yeah.
Right.
Little fun fact. Yeah.
It made me quiver. See, I did two things with that. Okay, next. Linda Blair.
Oh, yes.
Oh, wow.
Hell Night.
Yes.
And oh, yeah, she was in a little film called, she was little Reagan McNeil. Poor little Reagan McNeil.
Poor little Reagan. Yeah. Well, Reagan, or Linda, is, she's, I'm going to say 62.
Three for three, Jennifer. She'll be 61 years old.
See? That two years saves me every game.
You know what? A fun fact about Linda Blair, she's 5 feet tall.
She's an itty bitty.
She's adorbs.
She's so cute.
Oh, yeah. And then before we have a breaking news, and then Sean and Eric.
All right.
All right. Now, I don't remember. We did a whole clown show before about crazy clown stories.
Yeah, we did.
This didn't just happen, but I'm calling it breaking news. So, breaking news. A 29-year-old man was slashed to death in the parking lot of Torchy's Taco in downtown Denver, Colorado. On Tuesday morning, witnesses referred to the suspect as a man in white clown makeup. The assailant was allegedly sporting a glove with blades.
Oh.
To be 2 to 3 inches long on him.
Oh, wow.
Following the incident, the clown-faced man was seen hopping aboard a scooter and riding away into the night. Imagine the scene. Shortly thereafter, someone fit the attacker's description was spotted on an observation camera a few blocks away at the Denver Public School, throwing what appeared to be a knife into the bushes. So this was later confirmed when police discovered the knife covered in blood.
Oh, my.
Sometime later, a man covered in blood and clown makeup was seen riding the scooter near a busy intersection and was arrested. The suspect was identified as 35-year-old Christian Golzo, a local death metal vocalist. According to witnesses from across the street, the parking lot was empty except for the victim, who attempted to flee before being pursued by the clown. The victim tried to fight back, but witnesses said he just collapsed in the corner of the parking lot. The clown told police that he was the victim. He's just defending himself.
Oh.
But he was convicted of second-degree murder, and the clown is in jail right now.
Oh, well, where he belongs. Oh, my God.
Our introduction, our guests tonight have been here before, and they've been very busy since their last visit. Jen, do you know what they've been doing lately?
No. No idea. Of course I do.
They have a new show. Eating Whoppers and having a new show on the Travel Channel called Ghost Food. And episode 4 airs tonight at 10 Eastern time. Come on in, Sean and Eric.
Hi, Sean and Eric.
What's up, guys?
Thank you for having us.
Always so fun when you guys are here. Love it.
We already have fun, and they didn't even come in yet.
No, I know, right? Yeah. I know.
So,
how you guys doing tonight?
I am happy that I'm a marsupial, Eric.
Yeah.
you know, guys, you left out a very important celebrity birthday.
Okay, who?
Betty White.
Oh, I saw that.
Yes.
Betty White is 98 years old.
No, we have a policy about Betty White. Jimmy and I talked about this.
This is true.
People have a tendency to die after they've been featured on Celebrity Birthdays. So we don't mess with Betty White.
This has happened several times, guys, that we have saluted someone for their birthday, and then they
died within 3 days.
Yeah, or... Yeah.
Like a whole month in a row, they all die.
Yeah.
Terrible.
Yeah, it's pretty.
As a matter of fact, Jen, do you remember we did N.B. Davis? And not only mentioned her birthday, we did a whole tribute. A whole tribute, and she died the next day.
Oh, my God. That was upsetting. Yeah. So when they're old.
It's Eric's fault. And Eric, if she dies, we'll have you back on to talk about it.
All right, that's all my fault.
So she's going to be 98.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, where do we start with these guys?
How's Sean Sushi?
Yeah, Sean, what'd you get?
Oh, my God.
What kind of sushi you got Sean?
I don't know, those special rolls, man. There's so much love that goes into those rolls. You got crunchy, sweetness, salty. It's crack sushi.
Oh, God.
Isn't it just the best? I cannot stand cooked fish, but give me sushi and I'm the happiest girl.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan. I'm really not a fan. Over the years, Sean's got me trying different types of sushi when we're on the road, so it is what it is.
Oh, yeah. No. Sushi is absolutely food porn, in my eyes.
It is food porn.
I'd rather have
a
Whopper.
What are we doing here? Well, all right, guys, I have to just say, I saw your opening of your show when it aired the premiere, so fun. Mm-hmm. And I watched the rest today, and I can't wait to see tonight's show. This is fun. How long have you guys been in production now?
It was 2 months of filming when we did it, but we're already done now, so it's just a matter of them all finished editing and airing.
Yeah.
We've been home a couple of months now. We actually, tonight's episode was the first one we filmed, and we filmed that in May, actually. That was the pilot. And then we went out, when did we fly out, Sean? I think it was like the beginning of September. We were on the road for 2 months all over America doing our thing, and now it's on TV.
I know. It's so awesome.
So could you give us any myself? Hint out? Without giving it away, what's tonight's episode about? And where was it filmed?
We were in Florida. Sean, you want to fill them in on tonight's episode?
Yeah. This property was really massive for this episode, which I think gives a wide scale and perspective for the audience. Because there's a bunch of family members that live on this area. You pull into a road and there's five, six houses where family members live. Yeah. It's like their own little mini mm-hmm. neighborhood in the woods. And, they have such history there, obviously with hangings and lynchings and all this sort of mm-hmm. stuff. And, it took us in different parts of the property because you're not just thinking about one property. You know, they actually have this stillborn burial site where in those days, they would just bury these stillborns. And actually, Eric and I tonight in this episode, literally had amazing communication and experiences going on inside that, stillborn burial site. And one of our team members had an experience as well. What he was saying that was actually happening, and we weren't there for that. So you'll be able to check that out as well. It was an interesting case. It was our first case to film, so. But ultimately, there was definitely some creepy stuff going on. I actually was visited by this spirit. It looked like the thing from The Ring. And I actually told the homeowner, Teresa, that what it looked like, because she never said anything like, you know, oh, it looks like this or that. Like, she said, like, the, you know, dark hair, but, like, when I saw this thing, it literally looked like the thing from The Ring. Black hair over its face, like, just having its arm reaching out is right what you would think out of a movie. And it came with grabbing by my neck in my hotel room. So a lot of these spirits come to me before I go to cases when they know that you're trying to help people out or they want to, you know, push you away or kind of induce some sort of fear. And, you know, when I told her this, she said, oh, my God, it's like literally I wanted to say my son and I that it looked like The Ring, but I didn't want people to think that I was making it up. But I you know, yeah. All she was confirming exactly what I experienced is what she's been seeing. So, you know, that gave some sort of validity of what she was going through. And, you know, ultimately you'll see, you know, what we found out and, you know, what it ended up being.
Yeah, she was petrified. She was completely petrified. We were really happy to be able to go her and help her and her family. Like Sean was saying, it was the property's pretty wide. Her parents actually have a home there as well. I think her brother is a few houses down. There's like three or four houses on the entire property, but they've got all this land. And this is the only episode tonight where there's actually two trigger environments. And that stillborn baby cemetery, I mean, the creep factor is definitely high. It's a rarity to actually see something when you could do this stuff for years. And, you know, I go more on like feeling. It's rare for me to see something. Caleb said he saw something. Sean and I were actually in the house when that happened. But we did hear disembodied voices when we were at the cemetery. I remember something called me out. I don't know if that made the edit, but that cemetery was pretty creepy. And the house, too, I remember feeling a little off in the house. We spent a week on each case, and I remember having a headache pretty much every day I was in that living room. Yeah, we were just happy to be able to go there and help Teresa.
Yeah.
What was actually interesting is when we were – you'll see in the show tonight. I mean, I'll give it away. When we were in the stillborn burial site, I actually heard with my own ears a baby, like, moaning. It was like,
Yeah, and, it was incredible.
Everybody else heard it. And they caught it on audio. And
oh, I can't wait. Oh, I love it.
I really hope that makes the cut, because when we saw it, they showed us like a cut of it when we were on the road. And I'm like, oh, that's intense. I mean, you heard it clear as day.
Yeah. You know, it just, you know, that was a wide scale case, really. And there's spirits all over that property. You know, it makes it a little hard to decipher what you're dealing with when there's elements inside and outside, especially such a massive property. But, you know, we definitely had a big clue of who this female spirit was and what was going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what the creepiest thing in the cemetery I ever heard? And it was at night. Little girls laugh.
Oh, my God.
There's nothing creepier. You're a little kid in a cemetery.
Yeah.
I noticed on the Houston episode, you guys got a lot of really clear EVPs on that show. I was just shocked. I was like, oh, my God. I mean, it was direct responses and really clear.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you got to have good intentions. You know, we're there to help the families and the spirits, you know. So, I mean, Sean and I, you know, we were there to help these people. And they know that. The spirits are gravitating towards us. It's a rarity for us to not really get responses like that. It happens quite often.
That's awesome.
Hey guys, I really do have genuine intent, willingness to try to give a voice to these spirits and to willingness to actually try and help them legitimately. They will gravitate towards you like moth to a flame and give you what you're looking for, because they know that you're not going to treat them like a zoo animal and just say, do a backflip for me, this is great on camera, and walk away with a smile on their face. Yeah. I mean, like, you have to be down on that level with appreciation and be humbled that we're able to experience these spirits, because we are all brothers and sisters and we come from the same light of God. And when you have that approach and respect towards them, they can sense it and they can see it, I believe, around your aura of your human, you know, body. And that's why they'll come to you. And that's why they go towards the innocence of children. They're the most innocent creatures of us all, and they're fresh from the spirit realm. They have not been contaminated with the rational
perspective. Right. Their hearts and minds are still open, right?
Right. Absolutely. And, you know, a lot of these spirits are human souls that have not been able to let go of their human life that they once lived, whether it be a tragedy or they want justice for their death or they attached to locations, loved ones, objects, whatever it may be. It's something that they're not able to let go of. And a lot of them don't realize is that the human life is not the core element here. Our souls came to live here in our physical bodies to progress as our soul in this physical life and have an opportunity to bring a brighterness to our soul with the opportunity with our free will to share that light and representation of what God represents, and that's unconditional love and forgiveness through the lessons of life that we have to endure.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think that's what sets us apart, actually, from other shows that are out right now. I mean, I don't really see anybody else helping spirits cross over. I mean, obviously, we got the whole trigger environment thing. That's really cool. But, I mean, I don't see anyone helping spirits cross over on any other show.
Yeah.
Sean's been doing that
for
years.
Yeah. I've been trying to, you know, really wanted to push that out on the show because, again, you really just don't see that level of respect towards spirits. And that's why, you know, what I've been doing live on Periscope for years is that I say a prayer that I've come up with to say for these spirits, to give them incentive to go. And that's why I leave the spirit box on. So it's not just hearing an impression of what I feel, or if I'm telling you I have a feeling someone's crossing over, to have them respond to the essence of what's taking place while we say a prayer or after, it's going to give confirmation and validation of what's taking place, so that you can make a proper judgment assessment from there.
Yeah. Hey, Sean and Eric, before we go to break, I just wanted to tell, but for new listeners that haven't seen your show yet, what's the angle that your show's using? And then we could talk about the episodes that you've done after
Absolutely,
break.
Absolutely, yeah. Because like, people don't know. If they haven't seen it yet, they don't know what your angle is on it. Tell us.
Sure. Absolutely.
John?
Oh. I thought you said... Okay, sorry. I'm driving here, so I'm multitasking like...
Yeah, he's got like 20 pieces of sushi in front of him.
If you're referring to ghost loops, so what we're calling a ghost loop is basically the spirit is manifested characteristically the same over and over again. And this is what, you know, the homeowners are experiencing. And that's really what we're trying to find out and unravel is what the intentions of the spirit is and why the characteristics of it are very similar in nature. And that's where investigation leads us to the trigger environment to associate some sort of emotionally charged environment that's associated with the spirit part of their history that led to their death. So we have the best chance to get the highest level of communication to figure out what we're dealing with, why we're dealing with it, and whether or not we can talk sense into it to find peace or a path to peace, or if we have to force it off and displace it off the property.
Yeah, these trigger environments, they're luring the spirits to us, which you've never seen that before on any of these shows, and I just, you know, it's really cool. You know, some of these trigger environments are wild. And again, tonight, there's two trigger environments on this episode tonight. And I just wanted everyone out there to know, too, because in the beginning, everyone's like, oh, I don't get it. You know, what's a ghost loop? And everyone's saying it's a residual haunting, and these are intelligent entities that are caught in this repetitive haunting. And they're doing the same thing every day or every night at the same time. It's not a residual haunting because you cannot communicate with a residual haunting. And I've been seeing a lot of people on social media saying, you know, what are they doing? Well, it's not a residual haunting at all.
Right. And it's like I was saying, in a normal investigation, if they're trying to talk to a spirit of a little child, they might put a little teddy bear that lights up or something in the middle of the room. These guys recreate the whole room as it was at that time.
Yes. Mm. Yes. They recreate the situation. It's amazing.
And tell us, when can people watch this? What time is it on? What channel and all that?
Travel Channel.
So 10 p.m.
Friday
night.
Yeah, 10 o'clock.
Yep.
It's on any time. Depending
anytime
where you are,
you
it's
watch,
on any time.
It's on all the time.
Travel Go app.
Travel
people can
app.
Go on the Travel Go app as well to watch it.
Yeah. How many episodes have you guys done?
Eight.
You did eight. That's great.
Yep.
So we have so much to look forward to, Jim.
Yeah, tonight's the halfway point.
Oh, that's so cool. Now, here's a question I have for you. How did the locations get picked for shows like yours? How does that come about?
At first we thought we were going to be able to pick them out, but the network kind of took care of all that for us. And, when it was ready to be filmed, they just flew us out, and we picked them off one by one, spent a week at each location.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, we come into all these different locations, and I'm for that retrospect to not actually be aware of what we're dealing with in some of the cases, it's kind of a good and a bad thing. For someone like me too, even the second episode with the tall man thing, I had no idea what that lady was experiencing, and that thing came to me in my hotel room too. So when this big, tall, huge shadow came at me and I went to sleep paralysis and something called the tall man to me, by the time we got there, and by the way, the car thing, and I know a lot of people are speculative about that. Let me tell you, we were driving in the car and one of the crew members was actually driving us. So we weren't filming what was happening. And out of nowhere, I feel this rumble in the car, and the wheel just jumps off the car. It's flying down the road like 30 miles per hour, almost hits another car, and we're looking at each other just perplexed. We get out of the car, and it's just like, what the hell? And there's people pulling over and asking us if we needed help, and I'm having them look at the tire with something like a few of the lugs still on there, and they're like, that's not normal. That shouldn't happen, because I know nothing about cars. But is it definitely paranormal? I don't know. Was it weird? Absolutely. Did I ask in the spirit box in the car when we sat there if it was the tall man? Yes. Could have been playing games to try to take credit for it? Yes. I don't know, but it was weird. When we were inside the house, it said tire injure. It said Sean. Yeah. It was very, targeted. Crazy. It was very strange.
Wow.
Please, tall man, don't be under my car. I'm losing lug nuts.
Right, that was pretty wild. We're on the way to the location, and the tire literally got torn off the van. And, Sean and I, I go running across the highway trying to get EMS levels on the friggin' tire. Sean's already got the spirit box out in the van. I'm like, I can't believe this just happened. You've got to be kidding me.
Yeah, that was pretty weird. That was really weird, guys.
Guys, and you know what? They have a Facebook page that's called Fans of Ghost Loop. And we're simulcasting in your fan page. So anybody on Facebook, if you want to join Fans of Ghost Loop, it's on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about our break time, I think.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Oh, are there refreshments?
Come back.
Are there refreshments?
It goes by quick. There'll be refreshments provided by our Burger King.
Yeah.
BurgerKing.com. Please visit our website.
And let's talk about sleep paralysis too when we get back.
Yep. We're talking to Sean and Eric from Ghost Loop. That's on Travel Channel tonight, 10 o'clock Eastern. You're listening to Haunted Chronicles with Jennifer Runyon and Mr. Haunted. We'll be right back after these important messages. Welcome back to the Haunted Chronicles, home of your guaranteed shout-out at halftime. And there's at least 6 pages sharing the show tonight, so I'm going to try to be patient and get to every single person that are on the pages anyway. So, thanks for listening. In the Ghost Loop fan page, got Nancy and Misty and Mama Roseanne listening.
Mm-hmm.
And, let's see, on this page, we have Corey, my research assistant, Patty Hetherington, and Sherry, and Mara, Dwayne, Deborah, Candy, Billy, Diane, Gail, Kate, Roseanne, Michael, Corey, Jean, Sarah, Stan, Cheryl, Bonnie, Stephanie, and it says 6 more, and I can't even see them. They're dots, and it's crazy.
Crazy.
I need a helper.
There's I know. Tessa
and Doug and William over here, and over here, Julia, Barb, and Marguerite, Diane, and Wade, and in the chat room, we have Nan, UFO Fred, Invisible, Tina Smith, Shady, Nicholas, Nancy, Just Deb, Indy Dwayne, Dr. Dave, Double D, Desi, Deborah, and let's call it there. Oh, we got some extra shout-outs tonight.
Yeah.
Jennifer, Do you want to
Yes, I do. I have a special shout out tonight to my dear, dear friend, Cindy Foster. She's amazing. I love you, Cindy. And to Jane Bergmark. And they are listening. They're having a pajama party tonight and their first episode of Haunted Chronicles. So welcome, ladies.
And I'd like to also thank Cindy and Jane, the Hey Mickey Singers. And please, we can't forget Salem, Brady, Smitty, Mary and Larry, and Rick, and Junebug, and Amy Elizabeth, and Frankie B. And Sherry, thank you.
Awesome.
Oh, so anyways, time's up. Thanks for joining us, Sean and Eric. We'll see you next time.
I know. The pages are getting longer and longer. So, it's awesome. You guys are amazing. Thank you.
You wanted to ask about paralysis?
Well, yes. The episode you did in Lubbock, I believe, is the one that there was a lot of sleep paralysis involved in that. Explain sleep paralysis to people. I've had it. I still don't understand it.
Well, I've had a lot of experience with sleep paralysis. It's happened to me many times. I wrote a whole chapter about it in my first book, Shadow Chaser. What I believe is actually happening is your soul's actually shaking within your physical body. And knowing that when people have outer body experiences while they sleep, it's called astral projection. And when they leave your body, sleep paralysis occurs. And when you return to your body, it happens. It's a natural occurrence that can happen to people. And it's like tied into lucid dreaming, but also a negative spirit can actually float over them and trigger this same response within you to try to induce some sort of fear to get that energy from you. So, and that's what I believe actually happens. Your soul's kind of like bouncing in and out of your body. And what's the most fearful position and vulnerable position that you would actually feel? It's being paralyzed and you can't even do anything. You can't even scream. I mean, you're just watching this whole event unfold, and that's probably the most terrifying thing that anyone could think of. And there's a lot of people out there experiencing these things. It's all over the map, all over the world, but there's a lot of negative spirits that are associated with it. I would always try to say differentiate between if you're seeing something over you, hovering over you, then I would say it could lean towards possibly a negative entity. But if there's some sort of other experience, it's very easy to assume a negative spirit's over you and doing that to you, because if you feel paralyzed, you feel like something's stepping on top of you, but it's not always the case.
Yeah, I just remember when this would happen to me. The first time it ever happened, I was with my cousins, and I remember, you know, just this heaviness, and I opened my eyes, but I couldn't move. But I could kind of see, I could see the whole room, and right. I didn't see anything above me, but, it, you know, and it happened quite a bit to me when I was younger, so it's definitely left a mark on me.
That's and scary. And when you actually see out of your eyes, like it looks like a bad documentary when you're seeing outside of your body. I've seen myself sleep many times, bouncing out of my body and just watching this. It's really creepy, the whole experience, but it's fascinating at the same time.
Yeah, definitely. So tell us about the episodes you guys have done that have aired so far. I mean, tell us about the Lubbock episode.
Yeah, well, obviously, you know, I went into a little bit about the tall man thing, and then, you know, we ended up, the trigger environment we came up with was the train car. We did find some sort of history that there may have been a man that was 7 feet tall that was, you know, he would rob people and throw them off the train. And it tied into possibly who this tall man was. But we also did research on Hell's Gate, and there was this tall type shadow. They had another name for it. I forget what it was that people would see darting around the place. And knowing that this girl had gone there and investigated the paranormal with some friends, and her friends played with the Ouija boards. And
episode at all, actually. They didn't leave any of that in about the Ouija board. So, yeah. I mean, there's definitely more to it. Yeah, there's definitely more to it. He messed around with a Ouija board, and he invited something in, and he didn't get rid of it in the proper way. He set the thing on fire, and we had a whole interview with him, and none of that made it to the episode. So there's definitely more to that case than what you saw.
Maybe we'll get the extra bonus footage on the DVD release.
Yeah.
Hey, so for breaking news, I have a black box that appeared on my computer, and it's blocking the chat room, so... if there's any questions in there, I can't see them. Sorry.
Oh, Sean, why don't you tell them about the EVP you got that actually, you got an EVP when you were at under the bridge, and it actually sounded like a train. I was at the house, but I was in the graveyard when that happened.
Yeah, that was amazing too. I mean, obviously, like some spirit told me this thing was the tall man. And if you notice, like every time I'm like, is the tall man watching? And it would say, yes, yes, he's watching. And, you know, to be under those train tracks and use two different devices that are completely different, how they extract some sort of energy from the spirits to manipulate, to let these devices give us communication, to get a train noise through the spirit box and the phasma
That's
box
incredible.
That we were using. I mean, we were right under the train tracks. I mean, that was kind of just like a key element and clue that we were just like, it really has something to do with the train. And that's why it led to us, you know, with Eric, you know, having his part in the building that train car in the house. Yeah, it's pretty wild.
Mm. Yeah, I was stuck in a cemetery for about 3 hours when Sean was under the bridge. But it was a cool cemetery nonetheless. 60,000 people buried there, and someone very famous, Buddy Holly, is buried in that cemetery.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Get it?
You were too busy kissing the feet of a statue of an angel, Eric, in the cemetery.
What was that? What was that?
Yeah, explain that.
I didn't want anything following me home. Apparently, the statue watches over everyone there, and, you know, they wanted us to kiss the feet of this statue, and everyone's safe, and no one will be followed home. So, all right, you got like three cameras on you. Sure, I'll kiss the feet of the statue. Why not?
My opinion is like, it's an urban legend, and I don't want people, you know, I wouldn't want people to be like, you know, following in the footsteps, like doing it. I mean, you know, because I actually, like, Michelle was actually scared to like kiss the feet of the angel. I mean, you know, it's just, people could always, after the show airs, you don't want them falling into the cemetery and doing these, playing around with stuff. So, I mean, you never know what can happen.
So what is the scariest thing, aside from the show, that you personally, both of you, have experienced?
Oh, my gosh.
I mean, seriously, 2 days ago.
All about Letchworth the other day. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, yeah, we were in this haunted place. We've been so many times. Like, I've written about it in my book. It's a mental hospital. It's beyond super haunted. It was just really dark. We saw some black shadow like dart around. This is during the day. And yeah, we were live streaming, and like, we heard this like noise like ruffling around in the door, you know, closed on its own. We didn't realize till after we looked back on the footage.
Yeah.
And like this, I could just sense this thing was like evil laughing. And Eric got a little terrified because I made like an evil laugh, and he looked at me, Sean, don't do that. Don't do that.
Oh my
He's,
dude,
like, a little terrified.
Like,
I was like, dude,
you've been here like 20 times. The place is so haunted. Why are you doing that, bro? I mean, that place is, the creep factor is up there. That place is super haunted.
Yeah, crazy. It's crazy. I mean, but, you know, we prayed for a spirit there. We got some amazing confirmation that we helped a female spirit. And again, every time you go to these dark places where there's human suffering, and there's definitely some satanic rituals that took place in this dormitory where we were, these things hate it. They get so pissed off, and it doesn't make them happy. I've had, you know, so many terrifying things. I always talk about, it's in my book, Shadow Chaser. You know, this story that I went to Ohio with these, this guy that I believe he sadistically tortured and killed these women when they were alive. And I was in this place in Ohio, and he was trapping these girls, I believed, and I prayed for them, and they gave me confirmation that I helped them. And ever since then, this man would follow me around. I had left the property that night, and I kept on hearing in my head, you have hell to pay. The first night I was in my hotel, I was dozing off, and I saw this red face with yellow eyes and fangs and black horns coming out of his head. And it had this downward stare that like stared into my soul. It was probably the most unsettling feeling I've ever felt in my life. Jumped up, threw holy water all around my hotel room. And when I actually got home, I drove home. It's like a 7-hour drive. I was exhausted because I've been investigating for like days. And I was laying in my bed, and I see this shadow dart around my bed. And then I see this man, and there's a drawing of this man in my book. He's taking his finger across his neck. His face is all decrepit and like decomposed, saying like, you're dead. And then I saw this shadow at the corner of my bed. It had horns and it said, there are rules. And it, like, when it spoke, as if
my whole room shook. Oh my God.
So I don't know what it was referencing, but the only thing I can think is that I took a soul away from the devil and it's not happy. But if those are the rules that I broke, then, those are the rules that I want to break.
or some bad sushi.
Oh yeah.
Oh my God.
Oh my God. Remember Willie saw something paranormal with horns, Jimmy, remember?
Our friend Willie Ames.
Yeah.
Was on the show years ago, and he shared a picture. He's actually a really good artist. He drew a picture of this creature that was walking between rooms in the hallway, right? And yep. it was a regular looking big man looking thing, but big giant almost ram horns coming out of his head.
Yeah, he was pretty freaked out by that.
Incredibly frightening, but at the same time, like, that's got to be cool to see something like that. I don't know what I would do if I actually saw like a straight up manifestation, like a demonic creature. It's always in the back of my head. Like, when Sean and I were at Letchworth this weekend, I'm like, you know, there's been claims of people seeing things like that walk through that building. I mean, they did an episode of Ghost Adventures and some kid and girlfriend saw a demon walking through that place with big piercing wide eyes, and its legs were like all decrepit and bent backwards. I don't know what I would do if I seen one of these things. So when we're there the other day and all of a sudden Sean lets out this really creepy laugh, I'm like, you got to be kidding me, bro. What is happening right now? Not the place. Not the place to fucking play games like that. No.
Sometimes you just got to mess with your partner.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, that place sticks with you like spiritual glue. And those are the fascinating places that I love that just kind of just interest me. When it sticks with you for a while, there's something so profoundly spiritually, energetically, so powerful that it stays with you for a while. And I felt it like all week, that place. And then I actually investigated a 1700s house on Saturday. I'm sorry. Was it Sunday night? And we went Sunday during the day, and like the entire night it was referencing Letchworth while I was in the place. And
wow.
You know, just 2 days ago, I got this flash vision of this not pretty female face, white face. She had white eyes and a hood, and I heard this lion roar under her. I'm like, oh, okay, you're probably not so nice.
did you say unpretty?
Unpretty. Unpretty. He did. I've never heard someone say unpretty before.
That's a nice way of saying ugly. Yeah. Hey, my new friend, she's unpretty.
You know, I was going to bring up something about Ghostbusters. By the way, like, I'm so stoked for that new Ghostbusters movie. I mean, obviously people like us, but I mean, even as a kid, I was in such a classic movie. But I wanted to tell you about a strange dream vision I had after the night after the trailer was released.
The first one or the new one?
The new one.
Uh-huh.
So the next night I had this vivid dream that Dan Aykroyd's sitting there, and I'm telling him, like, you know, it's really awesome what this movie's done over the years. You know, it gets you excited about the whole subject, and it's really awesome that you really respect the legacy of Harold Ramis, because I know it's sad that he's dead.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden Harold Ramis walks up and he's in his Ghostbuster outfit. He's got like Stay Puft Marshmallow all over him, and he whispers in Dan Aykroyd's ear. And he's like, you know, you're going to have a movie one day, too. And I woke up and I'm scratching my head about it. I go to my bathroom. I go back to bed. And then the dream continued. And this time, this was speaking through a radio. And he was telling me about how my movie was. There was going to be a movie that's going to come out because of me. I don't know if it's true, but it's just
okay,
a really
strange. Okay, well, you heard it here, folks. You heard it here on the Haunted Chronicles.
So usually when you get some sort of sign like that, Sean, I mean, it's legit. I remember 2 years ago, Sean and I are on our way to an investigation together, and he's like, Eric, I don't know, man. I keep hearing Travel Channel in my head. And I'm like, well, maybe you're going to be on TV again, Sean. Boom, here we are on the Travel Channel. Ghost Loop. You know?
It was 2 years before this happened. And actually, the day after I first interviewed for Ghost Loop, I was live streaming for in front of about 1,000 people. The video is on my YouTube page. If you type in Ghost Loop's Ghost Loop Predicts in YouTube, I was live streaming. Nobody knew about it, and all of a sudden my grandparents are buried there, and all of a sudden they keep coming through very prevalently. And I'm just like, why do they keep coming through? And they go, they want to talk. I'm like, they want to talk about what? And it goes, TV new series next year. It goes, idea, ghost loop. And it goes, five of you leave, all straight on the spirit box. They're clear as day. You can hear it on my YouTube. And everybody in the chat was asking, are you gonna have a TV show? And I couldn't say anything. And it was not until a year later that I finally knew that we had the show airing, and I just posted it.
Wow. I saw that. I didn't click. I was going to watch it. And I'm like, what is that about? But I got distracted here at the house with something. But I saw that there was a clip of that. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's amazing.
There's no conception of time in the spirit realm. So obviously they can tap into something that we're not capable of fully of.
Yeah.
Did you guys have any incidents when you were as children or growing up? Paranormal wise?
I did actually.
Go ahead.
We don't have enough time for all that, man. But I mean, me obviously being more drawn to darker cases, and you know, I feel like Sean and I got together to investigate for a reason. There's definitely a religious undertone to what we do, with us both being Catholic. With that being said, when I was a child, I will never forget this. I must have been 7 or 8 years old, and I'll never forget. I'm in my bedroom. It's like late at night. I actually heard a voice say, "The demons are here." And the feeling that I got when I heard this voice say that was the feeling I get now when I'm in the presence of a demonic entity. So I know that, I mean, these things have no sense of time. So I know when I was younger, these things knew when this kid's older, he's going to go out there and he's going to do the work and he's going to try and steal souls from us. And that's what I'm doing now when I go out there and I help these families with Sean. So when I was a child, that was the one that sticks out. I mean, that scared me. And I remember talking to my folks about that, and the look on their faces, they were just like, just make sure you say your prayers. And, you know, they were always believers in the paranormal. So, I mean, think of, you know, your kid coming up to you and telling them, I heard this last night when I was trying to sleep. That definitely struck a chord to me when I was a child.
I was wanting to ask you guys, have family members of yours had experiences as well?
My mother has. Oh, yeah. There's actually psychics in my family tree. Mm-hmm. So there's like some lineage connections to some of the spiritual abilities, that my aunt discovered. So that could be a part of it as well. But yeah, I mean, I never realized I had my abilities until I started actually investigating, engaging, the paranormal as a whole. And I was so open to the possibility of what I was experiencing. Things just started happening. I started having premonitions and being able to feel and see and hear stuff. And it's still progressing this day. I've only discovered my abilities over the last like 8 or 9 years. But you know, it's amazing to feel like your own piece of equipment and have the opportunity to be another piece to the puzzle with all the scientific equipment and our personal experiences and so forth to connect all the dots when we're trying to help people ultimately.
So we have 2 minutes left. Can you guys tell us again what channel your show's on, what the name of it is, and where people could find you on social media, anything like that?
I mean, you can find me right on my website. I mean, my website, you can have all my social media. It's Sean, S-E-A-N, D as in David, Austin, AUSTIN.com. You know, I'm selling signed books, signed CDs, all that stuff. And obviously, yes. Travel Channel Fridays, 10 p.m., 9 central, even including tonight, in the United States. And check out our show, Ghost Loop.
You want to find me on Instagram? It's EVMetal81. My Twitter's EricVitali13. Facebook is just Eric Vitali. And yeah, I hope everybody digs the show. It's every Friday night, 10 o'clock, Travel Channel. We got 4 more episodes left, so we hope everybody tunes in.
Absolutely. And you know what? We should also give a little shout out to Sean, because you're an amazing musician and singer. So check out Sean.
And you know what? I forgot 3 shout outs. People are very upset. Liz, Monique, and Smog. Okay, thank you.
There you go.
I think that's about it, Jen.
I think it is. You guys are awesome. I love it when you come to visit us.
Next week, we have David Omen. Absolutely. From the Omen House.
Yes.
And Sean, Eric, Jennifer, Dr. Dave, listeners, good night. We'll see you next week. Good job, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Good night, guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.